Welcome to Pinnacle online coaching classes. In this video lecture, we shall talk about the partition of Bengal and the Swadeshi movement and the boycott movement. As we're going to talk about the partition of Bengal, so first and foremost, let me define Bengal for you. What does exactly Bengal mean in those days around the year 1900? Bengal was a provincial state in eastern India, and it covered an area of 189,000 square miles. The area was huge and so was the population. The population was 78 million. And in this area, there were people who spoke Hindi. There were Hindi speaking regions of Bihar, Uriya speaking regions of Orissa, and Assamese speaking regions of Assam. The Britishers felt that it was a huge area to be administered, and that is the reason they wanted to partition Bengal. In fact, this was the reason they gave to the people, that for better administration, they wanted to partition Bengal. And besides, the capital, Calcutta, which was the capital of the entire British India, was also located here. So Britishers gave the reason as administrative betterment, so they wanted to partition Bengal. Let us take a look at Bengal in the year 1900. The size of the Bengal around the year 1900. Now this is Bengal, covering Bihar, which is going to be somewhere here, then Orissa somewhere here. This is going to be current day West Bengal. This is going to be the region of Assam, and in fact all the areas of the northeast, the current day states, the whole of Bangladesh. This is what was known as Bengal in those days. So what the Britishers were saying, that it was too huge a unit to be administered with 78 million population, which was a quarter of the population of British India. What they were saying was true to a certain extent, but then they had some real hidden motives behind this partition, which we will cover next. In this figure, you can see that here we have Bihar, here we have Orissa. Bihar and Orissa, it was not partitioned then. The portion, upper portion, this is Bihar. Here we have Jharkhand, current day Jharkhand. This is Orissa, and this is Assam here, and this is Bangladesh, current day Bangladesh. And the Britishers proposed to partition here. In the year 1905, this partition had become effective. This was the line of partitionment. The arrow points towards the line from which it would be separated into two provinces, and this province on this side would be known as West Bengal, which would have a Hindu majority, and on the other side, this side would be known as East Bengal. The eastern side would have its capital at Dhaka, and this side would have its capital at Calcutta. So this is what the Britishers proposed. Now let us understand the real reasons for the partition of Bengal. It was Lord Curzon who was the Viceroy of India at that time when the partition of Bengal took place, and the real objective that Lord Curzon had in his mind was to weaken the national movement, which was picking up very fast, as Bengal was the nerve center of Indian nationalism. He wanted to weaken Bengal. He wanted to create two separate entities, and the basis for creating these two separate entities was that he wanted a Muslim majority in the eastern half with Dhaka as the capital, and a Hindu majority in the western half. He was trying to divide the population on the basis of religion, and he wanted to divide and rule, and this would weaken Bengal, which would lead to weakening of Indian nationalism and the national movement. He wanted to put the Bengalis under the administration. He wanted to divide Bengal on the basis of religion. He wanted to divide the population on religious grounds, and this in turn would lead to weakening of the Indian independence movement. The Indian National Congress was becoming more and more aggressive day by day, and this partitioning of Bengal would lead to weakening of the national movement. In fact, the Muslims, they were misguided by stating that they would get their own Muslim majority province, and in that they would have their own capital, and in a state which was united, the Muslims were not getting what they really deserved. So the Muslims were in favor of the partitioning of Bengal. But unfortunately, the Muslims did not understand what was the real objective of the Britishers. The objective given to the people by the Britishers was very simple, that they wanted to reduce the administrative pressures of governing such a huge province. The statement of Risley, who was the Home Secretary to the government, very clearly states what was the hidden agenda of the government. He stated that Bengal united is power, but when Bengal would be divided, it would pull into different directions, into different ways, and then the energy would move into different directions, which would weaken the whole movement. The partitioning of Bengal was announced on the day 16th October 1905. Although this had been made public in December 1903 that Bengal would be partitioned, but finally it took effect on October 16th, 1905. Please remember this. You could get a question as what was the date from which the partition of Bengal became effective. It was 16th October 1905, also known as the Day of Mourning. Now, the two provinces that were created were, one, West Bengal, which comprised of West Bengal and the provinces of Bihar and Orissa, and the capital would be Calcutta. And in this West Bengal, it was to have 17 million Bengalis, 37 million Oriya and Hindi speaking people. And the irony was that Bengalis was reduced to a minority in the province of Bengal itself. And on the other side, the East Bengal and Assam side, which would be known as East Bengal, it was the Muslim majority area where the total population was 31 million. And out of these 31 million, 18 million were Muslims. They had their capital at Dhaka. Now, let us take a look at the 16th of October 1905. It was observed as a day of mourning. People were very, very sad and depressed because from the day they had got to know that Bengal would be partitioned in the year December, in the month of December 1903, they had been opposing it tooth and nail, that they did not want such a partitioning. People woke up in the morning, they fasted, they bathed in the river Ganga, and they walked barefoot in processions. They tied rakhis on one another's hand, and this was considered to be a symbol of unity. This was the day of 16th October 1905. People were very, very sad. They did not lit fires in their house to cook, and it was basically a day devoted to taking prayers and fasting. People were completely heartbroken, and they had never felt that the British government would disregard their views and their feelings in such a way and would go ahead with what it wanted to do. Now let us talk about reactions to the partition of Bengal. The Indian nationalists, they very well understood what were the real intentions of the government. Why did they want to partition Bengal on such a way that two provinces would be created, one Hindu dominated and one Muslim dominated? They understood this very well, and very soon anti-partition movements and Swadeshi movements started in Bengal. Swadeshi and boycott movements, they have their roots in the anti-partition movement, which took place from almost, you can, from the year 1905 to 1911. 1911, because in this year the partitioning of Bengal was called off. The chief architects of these Swadeshi and boycott movements are Aurobindo Ghosh, Lokmanya Tilak, Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Bipin Chandra Pal, Lala Lajpat Rai and Chidambaram Pillai. What was the basis, what was the motive behind the Swadeshi and boycott movements? Why did our Indian nationalists start these Swadeshi and boycott movements? Now let's take a look at that. From here you could get a question, when was Swadeshi and boycott used for the first time? The answer is in the anti-partition movement of Bengal. Please remember this. Besides, they're going to be used here for the first time, and after this we will see that they will become an integral part of the Indian national movement. Now, what was the purpose, what was the aim for encouraging Swadeshi and boycott movements? Why were they adopted in the anti-partition movement of Bengal? Now, let's take a look at that. First and foremost, it would create pressure upon the British by the financial loss they would suffer by the boycott of British goods. Let me first take here, what do we mean by Swadeshi and what is meant by boycott? By Swadeshi, it is meant that everything that is manufactured in India is going to be used by the Indians. Slowly as India was being turned into a British colony, the raw material from India would be sent to Britain. It would be used for manufacturing goods there, and after that, those British manufactured goods would be brought back to India because it had a market in India and the Indians were compelled to buy those goods because we did not have developed industry, or rather industry at that point of time. And by creating and by buying these British manufactured goods, our own industry and our own goods were declining day by day. Now, if we were adopting Swadeshi, that meant we would not purchase British goods, and if we did not purchase British goods, this would lead to financial losses to Britain. When we would boycott means we would not buy those British goods. In that situation, it would lead to financial losses to the British government, and it would lead to encouragement of goods manufactured in India. So first and foremost, this would create pressure on the British government, it would cause financial losses to the British government, and the main two goods that were to be targeted were cotton goods from Manchester and salt manufactured in Liverpool. Manchester is a very famous place in England where cotton goods were made, and Manchester was famous for cotton goods and Liverpool was famous for salt. These were the two items that we wanted to target. We would boycott cotton goods from Manchester and instead purchase clothes manufactured in India. The boycott was regarded as essential for revival of indigenous industries. Obviously, when we would be boycotting British goods, it is not that we would stop using goods, we would use goods, but those goods which would be manufactured in India. And this would give encouragement to our own industry, and many industries that were there in the infant stage, at the very initial stage, they would be encouraged. And most of the times, these infant industries, they should be given protection, they should be given subsidy, but when they were facing British competition and competition from goods manufactured in Britain, how could they survive? So the boycott and use of Swadeshi would give encouragement to a lot of industries that were there in the infant stage. What is meant by Swadeshi? Swadeshi simply means everything that is Indian. And now, slowly, new political weapons began to be used, which created pressure upon the British government. And these weapons were Swadeshi, boycott. Initially, we started by boycotting goods manufactured in Britain, but slowly, this will be extended to boycotting legislatures, boycotting courts. It will be extended boycotting schools. It will slowly cover up all those also. And besides, the masses, the real power lies in the masses. Masses will also slowly get associated to anti-partition movement of Bengal. The anti-partition movement of Bengal encouraged Swadeshi and boycott of British goods. Now, it also wanted mass mobilization. And one of the most powerful method of mass mobilization was organization of samitis. What were these samitis? What did they do? What were their functions? How successful they were? Now that is what I'm going to talk about. What were samitis? First and foremost, samitis, they were groups of volunteers. Volunteers who would mobilize the people, who would explain to them what is Swadeshi, who would explain to them what are the harmful effects of using Britain manufactured goods. So first and foremost, definition of a samiti. These are corps of volunteers, or samitis as we call them in Hindi. They were another major form of mass mobilization. This was used in the Swadeshi movement. One of the earliest and the most successful samitis was Swadesh Bandhav Samiti. By Swadesh we mean from my own country. Bandhav, by Bandhav I mean my fellow brothers, and Samiti means organization. So it was an organization of my fellow Indians. And Ashwini Kumar Dutt, who was a school teacher in Barisal, that is a place in Bengal, he organized the Swadesh Bandhav Samiti, and he wanted to reach almost every corner of Bengal and explain what were the real intentions of the Britishers behind the partition of Bengal. And he opened almost 159 branches of the Swadesh Bandhav Committee, and its branches were opened even in the remotest corners of every district, and this Samiti was highly successful. What were the functions of the Samitis? What did they really do after they opened their offices in the remotest corners? What did they do? They took the message of Swadeshi, they explained what would be the harmful effect of the partitioning of Bengal. At nights, they conducted magic lantern lectures where people would gather in groups, and after that they would address these groups and lecture them and tell them what were the consequences, how the partitioning of Bengal would be harmful, why they should use Indian goods manufactured in India. Besides, Swadeshi songs would be sung, and they also gave physical and moral training to the members of the society. Wherever there were famines or epidemics, these groups went there and did a lot of work of charity and welfare. They organized schools in those areas where there were no schools, or where there were only British schools, they opened Indian schools. They imparted training in Swadeshi craft. They taught the villagers to be self-dependent and self-reliant. Even in certain cases, they acted as arbitrators. What is an arbitrator? An arbitrator is a person who acts, it could be a person or an organization, which acts as a middleman between two parties that are at dispute. These samitis, they encourage the Indians to be as dependent on themselves rather than on the British. So British courts were to be boycotted, and matters of dispute were to be sorted out in the villages through the panchayats or by arbitration courts. These were the functions of the samitis. And what was the reaction of the Britishers? The Britishers were greatly alarmed by the activities of the Samitis. As they became popular, the more alarmed the Britishers were. And these Samitis, day by day, their popularity increased among the rural masses. Now let us look at various aspects of boycott and Swadeshi. First and foremost, we will look at the economic aspect. It led to the regeneration of indigenous goods. So obviously, when the stress was on using Indian goods, so a lot of new industry developed, our handicrafts, our traditional art, handicrafts, which had lost importance by the coming of British goods. Now slowly, they started, their regeneration period started. The boycott of foreign goods led to increase in demand of indigenous goods, especially clothes, which fell short of supply. As we boycotted the cotton manufactured in Manchester, we started using cotton manufactured in India. There was one time when our cotton manufactured in India was even in short of supply. That means people participated in the Swadeshi movement with great enthusiasm. J.M. Tata, Jamshedji Tata, at this time, he opened the Tata Iron and Steel, which is even there till today, known as TISCO, Tata Iron and Steel Company. This is in Jamshedpur, near Calcutta. It is in the state of Jharkhand. Jharkhand is in West Bengal, but Jamshedpur is in Calcutta. So Tata Iron and Steel, which is the first iron and steel company of India, it was opened. Prafulla Chandra Ray, he set up the Bengal Chemicals Factory, and Manchester Cloth, as I told you, this was the chief target of attack. The movement was extended to other British manufacturers also. First and foremost, the Manchester Cloth was boycotted. After that, Liverpool Salt was boycotted, and slowly other luxury goods which were manufactured in Britain, they were all boycotted. Slowly we will see that even cigarettes, liquor manufactured in Britain, which was coming into India, all those were also boycotted, and people would burn them in bonfires. We could scenes of Bonfires made of Manchester cloth had become a common sight in Bengal. Let us talk about the role of the press. The role of the press was very, very important in keeping the spirit of Swadeshi alive. Every day when people woke up in the morning, they read articles in newspapers, they participated in processions, popular songs were sung, and besides, even a check was kept by the society itself. There were members who kept a check as to who was still using foreign goods. So the press also played a very important role. There were articles in newspapers, pamphlets, etc. were distributed. Fines were imposed on anyone who was found using foreign sugar. After foreign sugar, foreign cigarettes were also boycotted and they were bought and burnt in the streets. Brahmins refused to help in any kind of a religious ceremony. They refused to give their services if the ceremony was to take place in houses where European salt or sugar was used. And even business communities were warned that they should not import foreign articles. So we can see that almost the whole society was now participating as well as keeping a check on those who were not showing enough enthusiasm. When there was pressure from the Brahmins, when there was pressure not to import foreign articles, even those people who were not initially involved in the movement, they got involved in it. We just saw the economic aspect of the movement. Now let us take a look at Swadeshi and national education. The Indian nationalists had always laid stress upon the fact that Indians should be educated. Only when they would be educated could a proper development of the country take place. Only when they could be educated could they actually think out and understand the harmful impact of the Britishers being present in India. So one of the major planks of the program was self-reliance in national education. First and foremost, the Bengal National College was set up and Aurobindo Ghosh was the principal of this college, and this college was to be on the lines of Tagore's Shanti Niketan. The government of the British government obviously did not like it, and it adopted repressive measures and it wanted to crush all these schools and colleges that will come up now. In this period, the government will want that definitely they should close down as soon as possible. So the government tried to keep away students that were studying in government schools away from the Swadeshi movement. Those students who were participating in the Swadeshi movement, they drew upon the anger and the violence of the British Raj. Circulars were issued to threaten students, and they were told that if they participated in the Swadeshi and boycott movement, they would have to face a severe penalty to the extent that they would not be considered for government jobs, they would be thrown out of their schools, colleges and universities. The government was so petrified and so scared that even the cry of Vande Mataram was declared to be a punishable offense if anybody was found to cry out Vande Mataram in streets or in public places, he would be punished. This was a punishable offense. Strict orders were issued by the government to keep a strict check on the students, and all those schools and colleges which disobeyed the order, they were threatened by the government that very soon their recognition would be withdrawn or their affiliations would be cancelled, funds would be stopped to them. The government used all these as a pressure to create pressure upon schools and colleges. Even those students who were found to be participating in the Swadeshi and boycott movements, they would be declared ineligible for all kind of government services. The authorities in schools and colleges, they were asked to keep a strict check over their students, and if anybody was found participating in the anti-partition of Bengal movement, they were to be punished. And if the authorities could not control their students, then in such a situation, the education department would have to be informed, and then the education department would take the necessary disciplinary action against such students. And even principals of schools and or principals of colleges, they were asked why their students who had participated in the anti-partition of Bengal movement should not be expelled. So even kind of a responsibility was imposed on the principals. So not just the principals, the school teachers, the education department, everybody tried to keep a check on the pupils and keep them away as far as possible from the anti-partition of Bengal movement. But did this actually suppress the enthusiasm of the students? The more they were suppressed, the more they were encouraged to participate in the movement. And there was a storm of indignation and anger against these repressive measures of the British government. The Indian-owned press denounced the circulars issued by the government in the strongest language. Now, every day there would be articles in the newspapers regarding what were the new repressive measures of the British government. There was awareness being created among the people as to what the British government was doing. So anti-circular societies were set up, and these anti-circular societies, they rallied the students through processions, picketing and collecting of funds. Later, a conference was held on 10th November 1905, and this is quite an important conference because it established the National Council for Education. It is known as Jatiya Shiksha Parishad. Shiksha means education, Jatiya means in the regional language, and then finally Parishad. Parishad means an organization. So National Council of Education was set up, and the purpose of this National Council of Education was to bring education under national control and to make it on national lines. Their purpose was to organize a system of education in literary, scientific and technical education. So this is what happened on 10th November 1905. And after the establishment of this board, the National Council for Education, we will see that a lot of schools and colleges will come up for literary, scientific and technical education. Besides, this National Council for Education also focused on imparting education in the vernacular languages. So a number of schools will come up now, and now let's take a look at which one were those that came up. The first, Bengal Institute of Technology. It was set up for technical education. Next, we have funds were raised to send students to study in Japan for advanced learning. Another school, number of schools and colleges came up under National Schools of Education. The Jadavpur Engineering College was set up, and this Jadavpur Engineering College, it transformed into a university in the year 1956, and this was for technical education, engineering. Taraknath Patil, he opened a society for promotion of technical education, and under this the Bengal Technical Institute was founded. The hostile government hindered the flourishing of these institutes because they were all opened in the anti-partition of Bengal, during the anti-partition of Bengal movement. That is the reason that they invited a lot of hostility from the government. Let us take a look at the impact on art, culture, science and press. What was the impact of Swadeshi on all these? The impact of Swadeshi was most. Rabindranath Tagore, Rajnikanta Sen, Vijendralal Ray, Mukund Das, Sayyid Abu Muhammad, all of them composed songs, and these songs were on the lips of everybody who was in Bengal. No matter even if the government said that crying of Bande Mataram has become a punishable offense, but people were not scared. They not only just cried out Bande Mataram, but even sung patriotic songs which were composed by these eminent writers. And the most famous song in this period is Amar Sonar Bangla. Amar Sonar Bangla means my golden Bengal. It was composed by Rabindranath Tagore. And this song, Amar Sonar Bangla, later on it went on to become the national anthem of Bangladesh in the year 1971. This is the national anthem of Bangladesh. When Bangladesh separated from Pakistan in the year 1971, Amar Sonar Bangla was adopted as the national anthem. And there is another book, Thakur Mar Jhuli, which consists of fairy tales written in Bengali, also known as grandmother's tales. And this book is famous till date, and the writer's name is Dakshina Ranjan Mitra Majumdar. All these were written in the period of partitioning of Bengal. Great improvements were made even in Indian art. Prior to the partitioning of Bengal, the Indian artists, they generally looked at towards Victorian art for any kind of inspiration, but now they sought inspiration from our indigenous tradition of Mughal, Rajput and Ajanta art. Nandlal Bose, he was the first receiver of a scholarship which was offered by the Indian Society of Oriental Art. In this period, the Indian Society of Oriental Art was founded, and Nandlal Bose, he was the first receiver of the scholarship offered by them. Rabindranath Tagore, he gave a call for Rakhi Bandhan. The Hindus were to tie a Rakhi on the hands of the Muslims, and the Muslims were to tie a Rakhi on the hands of the Hindus. And this would be symbolic of Hindu-Muslim unity. And he wrote articles in newspapers regarding this, and he also wrote articles about Atma Shakti. What do we mean by Atma Shakti? By Atma Shakti, we means to become self-independent, to be dependent upon ourselves and to do away with the Britishers in all forms. Creative use of traditional popular festivals was made, such as the Ganapati and the Shivaji festivals, and these festivals were used as a means to reach out to the masses. So Swadeshi propaganda, the Ganapati and Shivaji festivals were popularized by Tilak, and Swadeshi propaganda not only in West India but also in Bengal. Let us take a look at the statement of Ramsay MacDonald, who visited India during the anti-partition of Bengal movement. He clearly stated that Bengal was creating India by song and worship. In the field of science, J.C. Bose, Prafulla Chandra Ray and many others, they pioneered original research, they encouraged original research, which was appreciated worldwide. Powerful press campaign against the partition. As I have already discussed, that the press also played a very important role in this period. The press plays a very, very important role, has a great role of responsibility, because it creates awareness among the people. And many prominent people, Surendranath Banerjee, Krishna Kumar Mitra, Prithvi Chandra Ray and other leaders, their speeches were published in journals and newspapers. And most famous journals and newspapers of this period are Bengali, Hitabdi and Sanjeevani. Please remember these four important papers of Calcutta. They are Bengali, the Amrit Bazar Patrika, the Indian Mirror and Hindu Patriot. All of them protested against the division of Bengal. Now let us take a look at the Swadeshi movement outside Bengal. Did this movement only impact Bengal because the partitioning of Bengal was impacting only the local population there, or did it even go beyond the frontiers of Bengal? Now let us take a look at that. First and foremost, the message of Swadeshi and boycott of foreign goods, it soon spread to the rest of India. The press created this awareness, and people living in other parts of India also got to know what was happening in Bengal and how Swadeshi and boycott were becoming popular there. Besides, our nationalist leaders like Lokmanya Tilak, he took the movement to different parts of India, especially the area to which he belonged himself, Pune and Bombay. Ajit Singh and Lala Lajpat Rai, they took the Swadeshi message to Punjab and they spread it in other parts of northern India. Syed Haider Raja, he led the movement in Delhi. Rawalpindi, Kangra, Jammu, Multan and Haridwar, all these areas witnessed active participation in the Swadeshi movement. Chidambaram Pillai, he made the movement very popular in Madras, and Bipin Chandra Pal, very, very famous Indian nationalist, he toured almost the whole of India and he gave extensive lectures on Swadeshi and boycott, and he encouraged the people to participate in the movement as much as possible. So we can see that Besides Bengal, even many other parts of India were participating in the anti-partition of Bengal movement. Now let us take a look at the role of the government. Were they mere spectators? Did they just allow things to happen as the people in Bengal wanted it to be? Or were there repressive measures adopted by the government? Now let's take a look at that. There were a lot of repressive measures taken by the government. The volunteers were very roughly handled, and if they resisted, the police beat them with lathis. They did not bother about whether they were beating rioters or whether they were beating people who were peaceful. Lathis were freely used by the police. Even the uttering of Bande Mataram was made illegal in a public place. And as I have already told you, the government wanted the youth to be away from this movement. So instructions were issued to educational institutions to control their students and prevent them from participating in the Swadeshi movement. The teachers and the principals were to keep a check on their students, and if they could not control their students, in that case, the education department was to be informed for disciplinary action. The government put a ban on processions and meetings. The leaders of the movement were confined to jail, and without any trial, they were put into confinement. The government adopted repressive and severe measures. But did these repressive and severe measures, did they tone down the movement? Did they discourage the movement? Or was it strengthened further? In fact, it was strengthened further. It was for the first time that women came out of the houses and they joined the national movement. It was for the first time that youth showed such a massive participation in spite of all kind of threats being given by the British government. And finally, the pressure created by the public will be to such a great extent that in the year 1911, the British government had to call off the partition of Bengal. Now, let us take a look at the attitude of the Congress towards the Swadeshi movement. What was the role of the Congress? Did they support the movement? Were they against the movement? Let us take a look at that. And in this, we shall take a look at the three sessions of the government, the 1905 session, the 1906 session, and finally, the next session in the year 1907. The session of 1905. Gokhale was the president of this session, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, and two important things were stated in the session. What are they? First and foremost, emphatic protest against the partitioning of Bengal. The partitioning of Bengal was criticized, and support was extended to the anti-partition and the Swadeshi movement of Bengal. Although the moderates, they were not ready to extend an open support to the boycott. Why so? It is because they did not want to invite any kind of anger of the British government, and they felt this was not right time. The time was not correct to express it so openly, because in the year 1909, the British government was planning to do some administrative reforms in India in the form of Morley-Minto reforms. So this is the session of 1905. Then came the session of 1906, and in this session, the extremists wanted the movement to pick up pace, and they wanted it to become more aggressive. But whereas the moderates, they wanted to tone down the movement, they wanted to keep it under control, they didn't want to extend it beyond the frontiers of Bengal. So both of them, the extremists and the moderates, they were thinking on different lines. And in this environment took place the session of 1906. 1906, the extremists created pressure on the moderates, especially on Dadabhai Naroji, who was the president. Now let us take a look at the Swadeshi movement outside Bengal. Did this movement only impact Bengal because the partitioning of Bengal was impacting only the local population there, or did it even go beyond the frontiers of Bengal? Now let us take a look at that. First and foremost, the message of Swadeshi and boycott of foreign goods, it soon spread to the rest of India. The press created this awareness. And people living in other parts of India also got to know what was happening in Bengal and how Swadeshi and boycott were becoming popular there. Besides our nationalist leaders like Lokmanya Tilak, he took the movement to different parts of India, especially the area to which he belonged himself, Pune and Bombay. Ajit Singh and Lala Lajpat Rai, they took the Swadeshi message to Punjab and they spread it in other parts of northern India. Syed Haider Raja, he led the movement in Delhi. Great improvements were made even in Indian art. Prior to the partitioning of Bengal, the Indian artists, they generally looked at towards Victorian art for any kind of inspiration, but now they sought inspiration from our indigenous tradition of Mughal, Rajput and Ajanta art. Nandlal Bose, he was the first receiver of a scholarship which was offered by the Indian Society of Oriental Art. In this period, the Indian Society of Oriental Art was founded, and Nandlal Bose, he was the first receiver of the scholarship offered by them. All these decisions were severely criticized by the Hindu leaders of West Bengal, who very well understood that the Britishers were trying to drive a wedge between the Hindus and the Muslims. The partition and the government measures led to the split of Hindus and the Muslims. The British government encouraged the Muslims and helped in setting up and in the formation of the Muslim League. The Muslim League was set up for the Muslims, and this Muslim League in the future would look after the interests of the Muslim community. Nawab Salimullah of Dhaka was the main man who was behind the formation of the Muslim League. He is considered to be the founder. Please remember the year of its formation, it's important, 1906, and Nawab Salimullah of Dhaka is very important, and the Britishers helped in the setting up of the Muslim League, and in the future it would be used against the Congress by the Britishers. Whenever the Congress would set up any kind of demands or create pressure on the government would use the Muslim League to counter the demands of the Congress. The movement lacked effective organization and political structure, and later the split in the Congress in 1907, when we see that the members of the Congress, they fight amongst themselves, the moderates were wanting to take the movement in a different direction and the extremists were wanting to take the movement in a different direction, all this will lead to weakening of the movement. Now let us take a look at the role of the government. Were they mere spectators? Did they just allow things to happen as the people in Bengal wanted it to be? Or were there repressive measures adopted by the government? Now let's take a look at that. There were a lot of repressive measures taken by the government. The volunteers were very roughly handled, and if they resisted, the police beat them with lathis. They did not bother about whether they were beating rioters or whether they were beating people who were peaceful. Lathis were freely used by the police. Even the uttering of Bande Mataram was made illegal in a public place. And as I have already told you, the government wanted the youth to be away from this movement. So instructions were issued to educational institutions to control their students and prevent them from participating in the Swadeshi movement. The teachers and the principals were to keep a check on their students, and if they could not control their students, in that case, the education department was to be informed for disciplinary action. Now, let us take a look at the attitude of the Congress towards the Swadeshi movement. What was the role of the Congress? Did they support the movement? Were they against the movement? Let us take a look at that. And in this, we shall take a look at the three sessions of the government, the 1905 session, the 1906 session, and finally, the next session in the year 1907. The session of 1905. Gokhale was the president of this session, Gopal Krishna Gokhale, and two important things were stated in the session. What are they? First and foremost, emphatic protest against the partitioning of Bengal. The partitioning of Bengal was criticized and support was extended to the anti-partition and the Swadeshi movement of Bengal. Although the moderates, they were not ready to extend an open support to the boycott. Why so? It is because they did not want to invite any kind of anger of the British government, and they felt this was not right time, the time was not correct to express it so openly, because in Swadeshi, a concrete symbol of nationalism, emphasized on Atmashakti or soul force, a thrust of self-reliance, a new confidence and reassertion of national pride. Now let us look at this point. The Swadeshi movement, it reminded the people that they belonged to a very great country. It reminded how initially even the small villages in India had been self-reliant. People now felt confident of themselves and their national pride was brought back. Now slowly they had come out of their houses, they were taking part in mass movements, they were being lathi charged, and slowly even the fear of the police and the British Raj disappeared. And people had a new confidence infused in them. Next is the permanent impact on development of many industries, because stress was on Swadeshi, so a lot of new industries were set up, such as textile mills, soap and match factories. Banks and insurance companies were also set up, and since Manchester cloth was one item which was boycotted the most, therefore the beneficiaries were Bombay and Ahmedabad, where enterprising industrialists came forward to fill the vacuum created. And in these areas we will see later that industry will grow, will develop and flourish. Besides, the Swadeshi movement had a lot of led to a lot of cultural development, setting up of many educational institutions in Bengal, and as per Mahatma Gandhi, the father of the nation, who will lead the movement in the future, the Indian National Movement, he stated that one of the most important benefits of the Swadeshi movement was that it taught the people to challenge and defy authority. Openly in public, the people were defying authority, the fear of the mighty colonial power was no more, and even the very ordinary men, not just people trained in politics, not just big politicians and nationalists, but even very ordinary men, they were no more scared of the police, and in fact not even scared of the prison. The Swadeshi movement, it was the first in the national popular struggle against colonialism, and the people now tasted what was going to come in the future years. Great improvements were made even in Indian art. Prior to the partitioning of Bengal, the Indian artists, they generally looked at towards Victorian art for any kind of inspiration, but now they sought inspiration from our indigenous tradition of Mughal, Rajput and Ajanta art. Nandlal Bose, he was the first receiver of a scholarship which was offered by the Indian Society of Oriental Art. In this period, the Indian Society of Oriental Art was founded, and Nandlal Bose, he was the first receiver of the scholarship offered by them.